three wise idiots. There were once four Brahmins who had been friends for years. Three of them were brilliant scholars. They boasted many diplomas and a phalanx of letters after their names, which we all know denotes high achievement and wisdom. The fourth merely possessed common sense. Since, however, they had remained poor, the four friends all decided that the best remedy for their condition was foreign travel. Before arriving at this conclusion, the issue had been loudly debated, and at length, they reasoned that with their limitless talent, they would be sure to network with the VIP abroad, perhaps even a king, who would better reward them for their perceptive skills than they were at home. So they set off. But after a few days on their travels, the eldest of the scholars remarked to the other two that he had been thinking that the fourth fellow, albeit their friend, really didn't have much to contribute to their venture. Yes, he was a good man with a solid reputation for solving practical problems, but he was unlettered and had never attended any accredited educational establishment. The result was the most paltry curriculum vitae. What would any person of consequence think of their friendship with a man so beneath their own attainments? How would he help their team achieve its objective of lucrative employment? Himanshu being his name, should be sent home soon so that they could make their more illustrious way forward without him. Yes, said the second scholar, Himanshu is but a hindrance to us. He should go. But the third scholar disagreed. This is unworthy of you. Himanshu has been our close playmate since childhood, and what is this partnership except old friends out together on another adventure? Loosen up and stop being so literal. Himanshu has often surprised us with how to proceed when we hadn't the slightest clue. And because what he said had some truth in it, nothing was said to Himanshu, and the four Brahmins continued on their way as if nothing untoward had happened. Soon they entered a forest, and after a few miles came to a clearing where they found a pile of old bones, which the three scholars began to pick over with mounting curiosity and excitement. Aha! Expostulated one. These are the bones of a creature that we can bring back to life. Doing that would be an excellent testament to our skills learned over so many years of hard study. It would be proof of worth, due diligence, impressive to anyone. Yes, I agree, said another scholar. No problem. These are the remains of a lion, male, and I know how to reconstruct his skeleton. And I, exclaimed the third, know the magic of how to provide its flesh and blood and fur. No problem. That only leads the breath of life, said the first, for his turn to come around again. I have the secret of how to make it live again. No problem. So the three brainy boffins set to work in the most expert way imaginable. Smoothly and quickly, one doing this and the other that, and so forth and so on, until lo and behold, all that remained was for that scholar who could infuse the beast with life to activate his secret knowledge. But Himanshu was uneasy and spoke up. Excuse me, but this is a lion we're discussing, isn't it? Don't you think it might be hungry once it's reborn? And won't we be its nearest source of food? How very droll and charming your worries are, Himanshu, said the tallest of the scholarly pals, with the pleasantest of smiles. To assume that we, such qualified theoreticians, haven't considered the variable which you raise with such anxiety. No, no, dear friend, the lion will experience gratitude at being revivified by us, his kindly benefactors. No problem. He will be a pussycat, mild and meek, even purring. Wait and see. Okay, said Himanshu, but if you don't mind, I'll just climb this tree first and watch the finale from safety. Oh, they laughed and they laughed, the other three, until tears of hilarity rolled down their cheeks. They roared with merriment. They slapped their thighs. They grabbed one another and whirled around in a happy jig at Himanshu's absurd caution. At last, they calmed down, and he who knew how blew the breath of life up the nose of the inanimate lion before them. Instantly it shook itself, glared about, and roared a toothy roar. Rather intimidating, it must be said, certainly unlike any happy pussycat. The scholars were briefly frozen in a perplexed tableau, uncomprehending at such unexpected result of their elegant experiment. But the lion did not tarry. While the brainy ones stood agape, he marauded among them, killing each quickly and devouring them before Himanshu's horrified eyes. Finally, the lion burped and ran off. Himanshu came down from the tree and walked sadly home. We're lucky to have this story because of his report to the local authorities. And the moral of this tale? Pick one or more. A. No problem is too difficult for a theoretician. B. A fudnik is a nudnik with a PhD. C. 97% of the solution to any problem is the correct definition of the problem.